Hello and welcome students. We are into the 28th video lecture of the video lecture series made on the subject of machine design, whose subject code is ME303, and the topic which we are going to discuss today is the design of journal bearings. This is the first part of this design of journal bearings, in which I will discuss with you about the concept of viscosity, viscosity index, and the Petrov's equation. These three are the important concept on the design of journal bearings. So we are going to study about this in this lecture. I am Shri Krishna Mishra, assistant professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering, Suresh Gyan Vihar University, Jaipur. Now, before starting our lecture, let's see what are the objectives of today's lecture. So these are the objectives of today's lecture, students. First, we are going to understand the importance of lubrication in the case of sliding contact bearing. We are also going to know about what is viscosity, what is the importance of viscosity. Then viscosity is inversely proportional to temperature. As the temperature of the lubricant increases, viscosity decreases, and this is characterized by a number which is known as viscosity index. So we are going to understand about viscosity index also. Then after, we are going to also understand about the full journal bearing and the partial bearings. Then the next lecture objective is we are going to know about the Petrov's equation. Petrov's equation is basically used to calculate the value of coefficient of friction mu. All right. Mu, or in some cases it is written as F also. Here in this particular lecture, we are going to take the notation F for the coefficient of friction, so that we don't get confused with mu, because mu is also used for the absolute viscosity. All right, then our final objective is to find the coefficient of friction in the case of thick film bearings. So these are our today's lecture objectives, students. Now let's start our video lecture. In the previous lecture, I have told you about the sliding contact bearing and what is the importance of the lubricant that is used in sliding contact bearing. Lubricant plays a very important role in the case of sliding contact bearing. What are sliding contact bearings? In sliding contact bearing, students, in sliding contact bearing, basically there was a sliding contact. There was a sliding contact between the journal and the bearing. If this is the journal, if this is the bearing and this is the journal inside the bearing, then in that case, students, always there is a sliding contact between these two surfaces. All right. So in order to, if there will be sliding, then the problem will be that always there will be friction, and friction will create a lot of heat, and this will cause damage to the bearings and even the journal is what? Journal is that part of the shaft which is inside the bearing. So even the journal can get damaged, and even the bearing will, the life of bearing will have to suffer if we don't use the lubricant. So lubricant is very important. Lubrication is very important in the case of sliding contact bearing. There are various advantages of lubrications, like it dissipates heat, it reduces friction, all right, and it increases the life of the bearing. So basically, this lubrication between the journal and the bearing, this is your journal, and outside of it is your bearing. This is your bearing. So there should be lubrication between them. Now, in the case of these sliding contact bearing, as I have told you, these sliding contact bearing can be subclassified into your hydrodynamic bearing and hydrostatic bearing. A sliding contact bearing, students, can be subclassified. Sliding bearings can be subclassified into your, which type of bearing? One is the hydrodynamic bearing, and second is the hydrostatic bearing. Basically, hydrodynamic bearings were which bearing? Hydrodynamic bearings were those in which in which the dynamics of the bearing itself maintains the continuous lubrication between the two mating parts. like this journal and the bearing, between these two surfaces always there is lubrication available in the case of hydrodynamic bearings. All right, here you will not see any pump that is used to continuously pump the lubricant, while in the case of hydrostatic bearing, you will see that a continuously lubricant has to be pumped inside the bearing in order to keep the two mating parts away from each other, so as to remove the friction. All right, therefore you can see that sliding bearings now can be said to be of two parts. One is your hydrodynamic bearing and the second is your hydrostatic bearing. So basically right now what I am going to discuss with you, the hydrodynamic bearing. In this we don't use any pump. Here by the dynamics of the bearing itself, by the motion of the journal itself, there is lubrication always maintained between the journal and the bearing. There are some plus point of the hydrodynamic bearing and there are some plus point of the hydrostatic bearing. Basically hydrodynamic bearing has got some negative points. What are the negative points of hydrodynamic bearings? The negative points of hydrodynamic bearings are that always they need some starting torque, because at the start there is friction involved, there is metal to metal contact between the journal and the bearing. At the start, when the bearing is stationary, when the shaft is stationary in the bearing, always there is metal to metal contact. This contact is removed only when the journal starts rotating. When the shaft starts rotating, then only this metal to metal contact is removed, and that too it will be completely lubricated. The whole surface between the bearing and the shaft, this will be completely lubricated only when a sufficient amount of speed has been attained. So this you can see, if this is the problem, then at the start, since there is friction involved, so starting torque will be high. So basically hydrodynamic bearing requires high starting torque. While in the case of hydrostatic bearing, since the lubricant has to be pumped continuously, in the case of hydrostatic bearing, there is pump used. Therefore, it does not require any high starting torque. Your hydrostatic, since uses pump to pump lubricant. All right, in order to pump lubricant, it uses pump. All right, and due to this, it doesn't need any starting torque, because there is always a lubrication between the two surfaces. Now coming into the next minus point with hydrodynamic bearing, the second minus point with hydrodynamic bearing is that only after attaining a certain amount of speed, the lubrication is available everywhere. Means it comes into action only after gaining sufficient speed. All right, and the third minus point in the case of hydrodynamic bearing is that it can be used for low and moderate loading. Means when the loading on the journal of the bearing is moderate, then only you can use this hydrodynamic bearings. While hydrostatic bearing does not have this problem. Therefore, they are basically preferred over hydrodynamic bearing, but it is costly. Hydrostatic bearing, since it uses the pump, therefore it is costly, but it still is used for heavy loading. All right.
So these are the differentiation between hydrostatic and hydrodynamic bearings. This I have already told to you for your understanding right now. For your revision purpose, let me tell you, in the case of your hydrostatic bearings, basically what happens from here, lubricant is continuously pumped. From here, lubricant is continuously pumped. And always the two surfaces are kept away from each other. All right, so this was your hydrostatic and hydrodynamic bearing. So you can understand the importance of lubrication in the case of hydrodynamic bearing. Now, if the lubrication is of such an important thing, then the second thing is that since this hydrodynamic has been also classified into thick film and thin film lubrication. Therefore, one thing is very important that if there is no metal to metal contact between the surface, then only friction in the running condition, of the shaft, the only friction that is involved is the friction between the two surfaces, two layers of the fluid. The only friction that will be involved will be the friction between the two surfaces of the fluid. All right, in the case of hydrodynamic bearing, if I am saying that there is no metal to metal contact at high speed, this means that students, there will be only one friction that is involved, and that is the friction between the different layers of the fluid. And the friction or the resistance between the different layers of the fluid, that is known as what? That is known as your viscosity. Viscosity is basically what? If you consider the different if you consider the fluid at the molecular level, you will see that there are different layers of molecules, and these layers slide above each other. All right, now if you consider two plates, one is this stationary plate and one is this moving plate, then students, if this moving plate is moving with this force P, all right, for load P is applied and it is moving with velocity U, then you will see that according to this concept of viscosity of fluid, this upper layer, which is in contact with this moving plate, this will be supposed to be moving with the same velocity as is the velocity of the moving plate. Means this upper layer will also be considered to be moving with this velocity U. All right, and the lower layer, since it is in contact, this is in contact with this stationary plate, therefore it will be considered as stationary, means its velocity u will be considered as equal to zero. In between, you will see that the velocity is increasing gradually from the lower layer to the higher layer. All right, and to explain this, we can say that viscosity is basically what? It is the internal friction resistance that is offered by a fluid to change its shape or relative motion of its part. All right, let's place a oil film between two parallel plates. In this diagram which you are seeing here, oil film is placed between two parallel plates. The lower plate has been kept stationary and the upper plate is moving with velocity U by means of some force, that is force P, capital P. Now the molecules of the oil can be visualized as small balls. We can visualize the molecules as small balls, all right, which rolls in layers between the two plates. The oil will stuck to the both the surfaces. We all know that the upper layer of the oils will stuck to the surfaces, and therefore layer of molecule which is in contact with stationary plate will have zero velocity. This particular layer will have zero velocity. Similarly, the layer of molecules in contact with the upper plate will move with velocity U. All right, similarly, this upper plate, the layer of a molecule which is in contact with this upper plate, this will be moving with velocity U. Now, what will be the condition of the intermediate layers? For intermediate layers, we can see that they are also proportional to their distance from the stationary plate. means as we move above towards away from the stationary plate, then the layers which are there, they are proportional to their distance. Means this layer, as compared to the previous layer, will have higher speed as compared to the its preceding layer. So based on this distance, which we can say as this, we can write as a small h. This small h is proportional to this small h will be proportional to the velocity. It will be proportional to the velocity of the layer of the fluid. So we can say if they are proportional to each other, if u1, for example, let's take u1, u2, u3 as the velocity of different layers. So u1, if for example, is proportional to h1, all right. Similarly, u2 is proportional to, for example, h2. Similarly, we can say u3 if it is proportional to h3. All right. This means that if they are proportional, if they are proportional in this way, then we can say that u1 by h1 is equal to u2 by h2 is equal to u3 by h3, and that is equal to capital U by h, means velocity with which the plate is moving divided by the distance between the two plates. So this is the relation. All right. Now moving further, and then now we will derive an expression for the viscosity. Students, see this tangential force per unit area, we all know, gives us the value of stress. So load which is applied divided by the area which is considered, this will give you the shear stress that is acting between the two plates. Tangential force per unit area will give you the shear stress. While U by H is what? U by H is the rate of shear. Keep in mind, this P by A is your shear stress, and U by H is giving you the rate of shear. U by H is basically what? U by H is giving you the rate of shear. Now, according to Newton's law of viscosity, we all know that shear stress between these layers of the fluid is directly proportional to the rate of shear at any point of the fluid. Shear stress is directly proportional to the rate of shear at any point in the fluid. All right. This means that rate of shear is what? Rate of shear is U by H, and shear stress is what? P by A. So this shear stress P by A is directly proportional to this rate of shear. Rate of shear means this velocity with which the moving plate is moving divided by the distance between the two plates. All right. So P by A can be said as proportional to U by H. Now, removing this constant proportional sign, if you remove this proportional sign, we will put a constant here, which is known as your dynamic. All right. So P mu A U by P is equal to mu A U by H. All right. This becomes the relations for calculating the viscosity. All right, now that what is the unit of viscosity? Unit of viscosity is poise. But since poise is a greater unit, and in maximum conditions, lubricating oils, viscosity is very less. And therefore, we use the unit centipoise. Centipoise is basically, it is 1/100th of the poise. Means 10 to the power minus 2 poise will give you 1 centipoise. All right. And 1 centipoise, another conversion can be said that 1 centipoise is equal to 10 to the power 9 minus 9 Newton second per mm square. All right. So 1 Newton second per mm square is equal to 1 megapascal second. These are the unit which you should know at least. Now, students, what is viscosity index? This is very important term which has to be understood now, that what is viscosity index? See, this particular viscosity, this resistance of lubricating oil, we have seen that there is viscous resistance of lubricating oil due to intermolecular forces between them. There is a resistance between the layers of lubricating oil. And as the temperature increases, the oil expands and the molecules move further apart from each other. And therefore, the intermolecular forces between the molecules, that is also affected. Therefore, the viscosity of lubricating oil also is decreased with increase in temperature. This is very important to know. If someone asks you what is the relation between the temperature increase and the viscosity, you can say that viscosity of the lubricating oil always decreases with an increase in temperature. And what is the reason behind it? The reason is that there that when the temperature is increased of lubricating oil, the oil will expand. All right, oil expands, and intermolecular forces, they become very normal. All right, they are affected. So basically, we can say the viscosity of lubricating oil decreases with increase in temperature. Now, in order to measure this decrease, we use the term viscosity index. In order to measure this decrease, we use the term viscosity index. Viscosity index is basically what? It is the rate of change of viscosity with respect to temperature. Rate of change of viscosity with respect to temperature. As I have told to you, viscosity index is the measure of rate of change of viscosity with respect to temperature. All right. So, and it is indicated by a number which is known as viscosity index. Now, viscosity index is defined as, it is basically an arbitrary number that is used to characterize the variation of kinematic viscosity of lubricating oil with temperature. So basically, it is used, this viscosity index is basically a number which is used to characterize the variation of kinematic viscosity of lubricating oil with temperature. All right. Now, as you can understand, viscosity index is very important term, since it is giving you the variation of viscosity with respect to temperature. So now, based on it, let me tell you what is Petrov's equation. Petrov's equation is basically an important equation that is used in the case of sliding contact bearing. Sliding contact bearing, this is an important equation. Because why is it important? It is important because it provides you an expression or equation to determine the coefficient of friction in journal bearings. It is why important? Because it provides you an equation that's important to get the value of mu. Mu is what? Coefficient of friction in the journal bearings. In the case of journal bearings, if you want to calculate the value of friction, as we are talking about the friction, heat development, and power loss. So due to this, the most important equation that has been given is by Petrov, and that is known as Petrov's equation. It is based on two assumptions. There are two assumptions on which the Petrov's equation is based. What are those assumptions? First is the shaft is considered as concentric. All right, or it is of circular throughout its length. It is of circular cross-section throughout its length. It is concentric. All right. With the bearing, the shaft and the bearing are both concentric. All right, and the second is that the bearing is subjected to light load, means this Petrov's equation is basically used for lighter loads. And second, the both the shaft and the bearing, the shaft and the bearing both are considered as concentric, like this. Both are having the same common center. These are the two assumptions, though these two assumptions are not at all possible at all the time, because I have told to you at the start, when there is no motion of the journal inside the bearing, then the journal is basically situated here. It is resting here. All right, and the centers we can see of the journal and bearing don't match with each other. So though these two assumptions which are taken by Petrov's equations, though these are not does not exist always, but still this Petrov's equation is important. Why is it important? Petrov's equation is important because it defines the group of dimensionless parameters that govern the frictional properties of bearing. Basically, it provides you a dimensional less parameters in which all the properties of fluid, this dimensional less parameter, which is obtained from this Petrov's equation, it governs all the frictional properties of the bearing. All right. In the diagram, you can see this is the journal portion of the shaft, which is inside the bearing. And here, there is some clearance that is provided between the bearing. This is the bearing. All right, this is the bearing cut section. This whole model is a cut section. This is the bearing and this is the shaft. In between you have clearance, and we are taking a small r as the radius of the journal. And the speed with which the shaft is rotating is denoted by ns, revolution per second. This ns is basically your revolution per second. All right. So now in the figure, as you can see, we are taking the R, capital R as radius, or small r as the radius of the journal, small l as the length of the journal. We are also taking a small l as the length of the bearing. Small l is the length of the bearing. Then radial clearance, this is space between the journal and the bearing. The space between the journal and the bearing. The space between the journal and the bearing, that is your clearance. Any particular area you can consider, this is your what? This is your clearance. All right. In top view, you can see like this. Then NS is what? It is the speed of the journal, which is given by, it is the speed of the journal, which is given by NS. Revolutions per second. Now, if these terms are used, then we can say that velocity at the surface of the journal, at the surface of the journal means velocity of this outer surface of the journal when it is rotating. How you will calculate the velocity? See, whole sole circumference has to be covered by any point which is kept at the circumference of the journal. So velocity, if you will calculate the velocity, how you will calculate velocity is basically what? You can say the distance into revolutions per second. Distance into revolutions per second. In one revolution, the distance that is covered by a point, if you are considering, will be the circumference of the journal. It will be how much? It will be pi d, or you can say 2 pi r. All right. And if you will multiply it with the revolutions per second, if you will multiply with the revolutions per second, you will get the distance covered per second. Means you will get the surface velocity. This means that, students, this means that 2 pi r. Basically, it is what? It is the distance covered in one revolution, and number of revolutions per second are ns. Basically, students, ns, 2 pi r is what? Distance covered in one revolution. All right. And what is ns? What is ns? Ns is basically your revolution per second. This means that combining these two, we will get what? We will get the distance covered per second. So basically, your surface velocity, or velocity at the surface of the journal, velocity at the surface of the journal can be written as u is equal to 2 pi r into ns. U is equal to 2 pi r into ns. U is equal to 2 pi r into ns. All right. So this is the surface velocity. Now moving further, students, according to Newton's law of viscosity, we know that the load or force with which the moving plate was moving, P, is equal to mu A, kinematic viscosity, into A into U by H. A is the area between the two plates. All right. So P is equal to UA, U by H. This is the Newton's law of viscosity. Also, we can apply this equation for viscous flow through annular portion between the journal and the bearing. Now, this Newton's law of viscosity can be applied here also in this journal, which is moving inside the bearing in the circumferential direction. So how we can apply? See, here the tangential force, let it be capital P, the force which is acting. Let the area of the journal surface, the area between the two mating surfaces, is how much? The area which you will cover will be the circumference. It will be 2 pi r. 2 pi r, not only 2 pi r. See, 2 pi r will be the area. 2 pi r will only give you the distance, this particular distance from here to here, this complete. But the surface area means the curved surface area. How you will calculate? You will have to multiply it with the distance. And what is the distance? The distance will be your L. So 2 pi r into L, this will give you the area, curved surface area of the portion between the journal and the bearing. And now surface velocity, I have told you, we have already seen that surface velocity is 2 pi r into ns. This is the previous slide I have told to you. Now let's take h as the distance between the journal and the bearing surfaces. Let's take a small h as the distance between the journal and the bearing surface, and let it be equal to c, clearance c. Let the distance between the journal and the bearing surfaces, like this for example, be the bearing, and in it let this be the journal, and let's for example the distance between them this h be equal to clearance c. All right, clearance means the space, vacant space. Now by using these all in this equation of viscosity, now using these all terms in this equation of viscosity, in this equation of viscosity, what will happen? This in place of mu, mu will remain intact. But this A, in place of A, we can write 2 pi r into L. And in place of u, you can write this u is basically what? Surface velocity. So you can write u 2 pi r into ns. This we have put. And in place of h, you can write this is the basically the clearance. This is basically the clearance, the space between the two mating surfaces, C. All right. So in this way, if you will simplify, you will get some equation, something like this. All right, and this is what, this is the force. This is the force by which the journal is moving inside the bearing. Now, with this force, you can also calculate the torque. You can also calculate the frictional torque. Frictional torque is what? Frictional torque is nothing but the load which is applied in rotating between this lubricant into the radius of rotation. This will give you the frictional torque. This will provide you the frictional torque. So frictional torque value can be given. P is equal to this much, means P multiplied into radius by rotation. This will give you the frictional torque value. This will give you what? This will give you the frictional torque value. So frictional torque value written by MT. MTF, frictional torque value, all right, is equal to P into R. And this can be written as, this can be written as 4 pi square R cube L mu ns upon C. What is this frictional torque? It is 4 pi square R cube L into mu ns, all right, divided by C. This equation, this is what is giving you the frictional torque value. Now, one more thing, students. Also, we know one that the pressure that is acting on the bearing due to this particular rotation of the shaft will be how much? The load that is acting on the bearing divided by the projected area of the bearing, divided by the projected area of the bearing. Means consider this particular diagram. In this diagram, you can see that the load that is acting on the bearing is W. If, for example, if you're not understanding by this diagram, consider this diagram. This is your shaft, student. All right. And this is resting. This is resting on a bearing. Now, the load that is acting on the shaft, if that is, for example, W. If the load that is acting is, for example, W, then we can say the pressure that is acting on the shaft will be equal to how much? It will be load divided by the projected area. Projected area means if from the top you will see, the projected area will be this particular area. This is the projected area. And what is this projected area? This will be your diameter into this length. And diameter is your 2R and length is your L. So 2R into L, this can be said as the projected area. So in place of a projected area, we are writing 2R into L. And W is the load that is acting. So this means that W is can be written as 2PR into L, where P is pressure. Now the frictional force that is acting, let's write frictional force as FW, frictional force. Let's write it by the notation FW. So this frictional force and frictional torque FWR, they will be same because frictional force is giving you basically what? Frictional torque. So we can say that frictional force MTF is FWR. And this will be equal to FWR will be equal to what? It will be equal to F into W. W, this we have calculated here, it is equal to 2PR into L. So F into 2PR into L into R. This is basically, on simplification, you can write F into 2PR square into L, where F is what? F is your frictional, that coefficient of friction. F is your coefficient of frictional. Frictional force was mu W, or you can say, don't get confused if it is written as F. Why we have written as F here for friction? Because here one more notation is used for mu, and that is your viscosity. Therefore, in place of coefficient of friction, we are writing it as small f. So small f, W means this is mu W, all right. And frictional torque will be your mu WR. This we have seen. So FW and FWR, how we will calculate? First of all, FWR will be F into, this is W 2PRL. This means that F into 2PI R square into L. This is your frictional torque. And between these two relations, which we have got right now, MTF, this is the frictional torque, F into 2PR square into L. this will be equal to the previous slide in which I have told you this frictional torque will be equal to by the Newton's law of viscosity. We have obtained this relation by the Newton's law of viscosity. We have obtained this relation. So equating this relation by this relations, equating this relation by this relations which we have got. Here is that relation. I missed that particular. Yes, equating this relation with the relation which we have got with this pressure. This is the relation, frictional torque relation. So this frictional torque relation, we are equating with which relation? We are equating with this frictional torque relation. So when we will equate, we will see that we are getting an expression. This we have equated, and we are getting an expression which is saying that this frictional coefficient of friction is equal to 2 pi square r by c into mu ns by p, where f is what? F is coefficient of friction, r is the radius of the journal, c is the clearance between the journal and the bearing, mu is your viscosity, ns is your revolutions per second, means velocity of the journal. All right, and P is what? P is the pressure is acting between on the bearing due to the load that is acting. All right, so this equation which we have derived here, is known as the Petrov's equation. This equation which we have derived here is known as the Petrov's equation. F is equal to 2 pi square into R by C into mu ns by P. This is known as Petrov's equation, students. Now you can see that there are two important dimensionless parameters which are there in this Petrov's equation. What are these two important parameters? These are the two important parameters, students. You can see this is the Petrov's equation. In this Petrov's equation, you can see the two important parameters are which? What are the two important parameters? R by C. This is a dimensionless number because there will be no dimension of this term. And similarly, mu ns by p. This is also a dimensionless number. So these are the two dimensionless important numbers. These are the two important parameters. In fact, dimensionless parameter R by C and mu ns by p. These two govern the coefficient of friction and other frictional properties like frictional torque, power loss due to friction, and temperature rise in the bearing. So always remember these two important parameters. All right, these are the two important parameters, R by C and mu ns by p. These two govern the different properties of a bearing, like the frictional torque, power loss due to friction, and temperature rise in the bearing. Now let's take an example, students. What is this example saying? First of all, let's read it out. Example is saying that a sliding contact bearing is operated under conditions. A sliding contact bearing is operated under stable condition. Means the question is of sliding contact bearing. The pressure is developed. The pressure developed in oil film is small p. This is the pressure developed when the journal rotates at n rpm. All right. This is the speed of the journal. The dynamic viscosity of the lubricant is given by mu. Mu is your dynamic viscosity, and the effective coefficient of friction between bearing and the journal diameter d is f. Which of the following statement is correct for the correct statement? F is directly proportional to mu and p. So is it correct? This is the Petrov's equation, which is giving you the relation between the different parameters. So from this you can correlate. Is it f proportional to mu and p? No, it is not directly proportional to p. It is inversely proportional to p. F and p, you can see. So option A is not correct option. Coming into b, f is directly proportional to mu and n. So is it directly proportional to mu and n? Yes, you can see in the relation f is directly proportional to mu and n. Here is mu and here is n. You can see directly proportional. Coming into the third one, f is directly proportional to p, inversely proportional to p and f. With p it is inversely proportional f, but second again f, no, this is not the correct one. Fourth one, f is directly proportional to mu and inversely proportional to n. No, it is directly proportional to mu also, and it is directly proportional to n also. So you can see that B is the correct answer for this particular question. Now, students,
now let's students discuss some multiple choice question in order to assess our understanding of today's video lecture. So these are the multiple choice question. We are starting with multiple choice question number one. The question number one is saying you that a zero film lubrication, a zero film bearing is a bearing where the surfaces of journal and the bearing are separated by a thick film of lubricant. Option two, where the surfaces of the journal and the bearing are partially separated by a film of lubricant and there is partial metal to metal contact. Option C is where the surface of the journal and the bearing are separated by a film created by elastic deflection, or option D, where there is no lubricant. So, since the name itself is suggesting you that zero film lubrication means there is no film of lubrication in this bearing, this means that there is no lubrication. So, among all the options given here, D is the correct option. Correct option is option number D. This was your MCQ number one. Coming into multiple choice question number two, let's read out the length to diameter ratio of a long bearing is, so the ratio of length to diameter for a bearing that is considered long is your more than one. All right, the options other than A are less than one, C 8, D 1. So among all the options given here, this answer, first one, that L by D ratio, that is the length to diameter ratio for a long bearing is greater than one. So option A is the correct option. Moving into this was our MCQ number two. Moving into the next multiple choice question. Question number three. Multiple choice question number three. What is the question saying? Boundary lubricated bearing is. So this is your question number three. Boundary lubrication. This is the name given to thick lubrication, thick film bearing. No. Thin film bearing. Yes. Then after, what are the other options? C is hydrodynamic bearing. No, we can say, but not that to extend. Then hydrostatic bearing. No, boundary lubrication means a lubrication in which there is partial metal to metal contact. Partial metal to metal contact. All right, and partial to metal contact happens only in the case of thin film bearing. So option B is the correct option. Correct option is option B. All right. Option B is the correct option. Coming into the next multiple choice question. Next is, compared with the babbitt, bronze is cheaper. Option A. Option B has high strength. Option C is it can withstand high pressure. And option D is it has all the three characteristics. So basically, all three characteristics are there in bronze, as compared with babbitt. So option D is basically the correct option. Option D is the correct option. This was your multiple choice question number four. Moving into the next multiple choice question. This is the question which is related to Sommerfeld's number. Now, what is the question saying to you? Let's read out. This is question number five. The question is saying that Sommerfeld number is. So option A is similar to bearing characteristic number. Option B is similar to Reynolds number. Option C is dimensionless parameters that contains all the design parameters. This is true, but let's read out the option number D, used to find out dynamic load carrying capacity of hydrodynamic bearing. So in all the options which here are listed here, C option, that it is a dimensionless parameter that contains all the design parameters. This is the correct answer of Sommerfeld's number. So option C is the correct option. Coming into the multiple choice question number six. So what is the question saying to you? Let's read out. If absolute viscosity mu n is the speed of the journal and p is the unit bearing pressure. Then bearing characteristic number is given by, so we have seen while discussion also that bearing characteristic number is basically what? It is mu n by p. Mu n by p is your bearing characteristic number. So option A is the correct option. Coming into the next multiple choice question, students, this is the multiple choice question number 7. We are into the question number 7, student. The question is saying that the popular bearing material is Babbitt. Because why Babbitt is a popular material? Because first option, excellent conformability, second, excellent embeddability, third, ability to be used in the form of thin chips, or all of the above three. So we all know these all three properties are there in Babbitt. So we can say that D is the correct option. The correct option answer of question number 7 is option number D. Now coming into the multiple choice question number 8. This is our question number 8. So in hydrodynamic bearing, when the shaft begins to rotate in clockwise direction, what will happen? The journal climbs to right hand side of the bearing without metal to metal contact. The journal climbs to left side of the bearing without metal to metal contact. Journal sinks to the bottom of the bearing, and the fourth is journal is at the center of the bearing. So if your journal rotates in the clockwise direction, it is very obvious, students, that it will climb towards the right hand side of the portion. It will climb towards the right side of the portion. So option A is the correct option. Option A is the correct option. Now coming into the next multiple choice question. Next is your question number 9. What is the question saying? Let's read out. The question is saying that in case of partial bearings, the angle of contact of bushing with the journal is usually it is 120 degree. The contact between the journal and the bearing in the case of partial contact bearing is generally what? It is generally 120 degree. It is generally how much? It is 120 degree. All right. Coming into the next one. Next is your question number, last multiple choice question. This is your question number 10, student. What is the question saying? The property of bearing material to allow the dust and abrasive particles to get absorbed on the surface of the lining is called. So we all know this is the property which is known as embeddability. Apart from it, the other options like conformability, no, viscosity, no, endurance limit stress, never. So option A is the correct option. All right. So these were the multiple choice questions, students. Now for your self understanding or for your self practice of the questions, you can use these as a reference books. I have used my whole of the material which I have explained to you by using these books. All right. So you can use these books for your self-study. So that's all for today, students. Thank you, students. Thank you and have a nice day.